This PCB from Midea is installed in many brands. Now, the problem is that the customer has complained about getting a P0 error. However, when we visited to check physically, we needed to confirm whether the P0 error was actually showing or not. To confirm this, we first need to remove this heatsink. So, we will remove the heatsink by unscrewing all the screws. The issue arose because the customer washed the unit with a pipe, and after washing, the P0 error started appearing. When you service a unit and don't remove the indoor or outdoor PCB, there's a chance that water can get inside the PCB. If you turn it on immediately after washing, there's a possibility that it could get damaged. This is what happened here as well. Upon inspection, this circuit has some areas that have turned black due to burning. In this case, if the IPM intelligent power module is damaged, the P0 error will show. Similarly, if the IGBT insulated gate bipolar transistor is damaged, problems can arise. To confirm whether these components are damaged or not, we will use a multimeter and check if they are indeed faulty. So, we will set the multimeter to diode mode. You can see that D601 and Q601 are installed here. We should not get a reading of zero, and if we do, it means they are faulty. Right now, the voltage drop is showing, which means they are working fine. We will also check the diode attached here. This is the cathode, and this is the anode, so we'll check it. It shows a voltage drop of 0.404. Similarly, we'll check the other side by placing the pin in the center, and it's working fine. Currently, the situation with the IGBT seems to be okay, but the IPM could be causing the problem. You can see that it has turned quite black, so the IPM might be short-circuited. We will test it by attaching the probes, negative to negative and positive to positive, and check it. This one is fine. Let's check the next point, which is also fine, but this point here is showing zero. The W point is showing zero, which indicates a problem. We will also keep an eye on the capacitors connected to it because sometimes, if they are shorted, they can cause issues too. However, at this moment, it seems like the problem is with the IPM. We will directly remove the IPM, and as usual, we need to replace the old soldering with new. We will first apply soldering paste here. If we don't apply enough solder properly, we won't be able to desolder it easily. We are sucking the solder from here, but sometimes this task becomes difficult. So for this, a very easy method is to cut the pins of the IPM. And see over here. Look at this. The IPM is completely bursted. Sometimes, situations like this arise when we wash the unit with water and make a mistake. You can see the state of the IPM due to this. But remember, doing this can also damage the compressor, so always work carefully. Remove the circuit before washing to minimize the chances of damage. This will reduce the chances of faults to almost zero. Now, if we physically inspect the PCB, all the small components on the low side seem to be perfectly fine under a microscope. The PCB, however, has exploded badly, so we will proceed to test the capacitors. Look, the multimeter is set to continuity mode. We'll place the probes on both capacitors, and there shouldn't be any sound indicating continuity here. Now let's reverse the probes, and we should hear a slight sound, showing that DC has been blocked. This indicates that the high side is completely fine. Next, we'll check the shunt resistor connected to the IPM, which is R606. We will test it, and its value should be low. Right now, it's showing 0.3 or 0.4, which means it's perfectly fine. Similarly, there is another resistor which we'll check as well. Its value should also be the same, and it's showing 0.3, so this resistor is fine too. Although the IGBT seems to be working fine, we'll test its diode in diode mode. Look at this diode, DZ601. When we test it, it shows a voltage drop of 1.134. Now, we'll reverse the polarity, placing the probe on the cathode and anode, and it shows 0.505 volts, which is also fine. Since the IPM has exploded, let's check the three capacitors on the left side. These are bootstrapping capacitors. We'll test them one by one. The multimeter is in continuity mode. This capacitor has blocked the DC voltages, which means it's working correctly. This capacitor has also blocked the DC voltage, so it's fine. Let's check the next one. Now let's switch the probe sides. There's no beep from this capacitor. Even in that case, the capacitor is still considered fine. Now, we'll switch back to diode mode and check the diodes. We will place the probes on the cathode and anode, and the diode checks out fine. We'll test the next one, which is also fine, and the one after that is also showing as okay. Now, it seems that the chances of low side components being faulty are low, so it has become essential to fix the IPM at this point. Now we are installing the new IPM, Intelligent Power Module, and its original number is PSS30S92F6-AG. If you look closely, the PCB number is also written on it, showing its original number. The original IPM that was removed had its number erased, but the new one has the correct marking. We will install the IPM properly, ensuring that each pin is carefully placed. Now the IPM is in place, and we've attached its base plate on top. All screws are tightened, and the IPM is soldered. After installing the IPM, it's important to test it. We will connect the negative probe to the negative terminal and the positive probe to the positive terminal and check it in diode mode. The value will rise and then show a voltage drop around 2 volts. I'll check all the pins and there shouldn't be a reading of 0 at any point. Now I'll reverse the polarity and as you can see, it's showing 0.489 volts, which is fine. The next point is also fine and the one after that is okay as well. The W point, which was faulty, is now fixed. This means the high side of the IPM is now perfectly fine with no issues. Now, we'll connect the PCB to the power supply and test whether it's working correctly. I'm supplying power to it, and you can see that LED 101 has started working and the switching is happening. So far, everything is working perfectly. The next step is to check the IPM in DC electric mode. We'll attach the negative probe to the negative terminal and the positive probe to the positive terminal. It's showing 286 DC volts. Moving to the next point, it's showing 14.73 volts, the next point 14.82 volts, the following point 14.93 volts, and the last one is showing 14.92 volts. This means that all the voltages on the high side are correct, and the PCB is now ready to be tested in the unit to check its performance further. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos, and subscribe. Thank you.